Hi, I'm Neal Ronaghan, editorial director of PixlBit.com, and I'm here with Edmund McMillen and Tommy Refenes.
Refenes.
Right?
Yep.
Yes. All Refenes. Right. And they are the two developers of Super Meat Boy for WiiWare, and also a cadre of other independent titles, including Time Fuck and the original Meat Boy. Ish, stuff like that. So how did you guys start off making games?
I started off making games, well, I guess I don't know if you can call them games, but I started working in Flash in like 2001, way back in the day. And I was doing Flash dress-up dolls. I did a series called Dead Baby Dress-Up, and that was my first experience with semi-game type interactive online things, and I was friends with Tom, and through Tom I actually kind of met at Tommy. I knew of Tommy way back then because he was doing similar stuff as well, and but we didn't meet up again for many years later. But that's how I started out, and then I stopped for a while and got back into doing art for games, and I freelanced for a company called Chronic Logic. And then I pitched Gish to them, and then that was my first legit indie game. That's how I started.
And Tommy, how about you?
Like Edmund said, I was doing Flash stuff a long time ago, and I quit that and got a job as just doing like web stuff, and then later server programming and network programming. And a friend of mine moved out to Amsterdam and was working at a company out there, and they needed a network programmer for an Xbox Live game. And I sold everything, like my house and my car and everything, moved out to Amsterdam. And while I was there, I was the network programmer, then I became like the render engine programmer, then I was the main engine programmer, and that company sucked, so I left and did my own stuff. And I did a game called Goo, which is not World of Goo, unfortunately. It won like an Intel award, but it never got anywhere. And then I met Edmund, and we made a game called Gray Matter together. And then we decided to do Super Meat Boy together. So that's about it.
Now, did you guys do Meat Boy together, or was that just Edmund?
It was me and John McEntee.
Okay.
I work with a lot of different programmers on different Flash games, and Meat Boy was the only game I worked on with John. John's not actually working on games anymore. That was his kind of one and only game. But him and me made Meat Boy last year around this time, and it did really well online. And it was around that time when we were talking to Nintendo. Nintendo had contacted me after I did, I don't know if you saw it, I did this Calls to Reggie video a while back.
That was you?
Yeah, that was me. I was recording myself calling Reggie because he and I had talked. I have proof that we did. he said that he told me about WiiWare and they were looking for any developers, and I just couldn't seem to get through. And when I put that online, I was contacted by the head of WiiWare development, and they asked if I was seriously interested in working. And I said yes, I would really like to, you know, work with Nintendo on something and get something on WiiWare. And that was around the time where I had just released a game called Ether. And they said Ether was perfect, and we were talking about that, but I didn't know anybody who would be able to program that. And around the time when I started talking to Tommy, and me and him started working together on Gray Matter, was around when Meat Boy came out, and I'm like, you know, Meat Boy was just way, way more popular than Ether was, and it's also a bit more, you know, straightforward, to the point, and retro, and kind of sums up the whole Nintendo old-school vibe, and I thought it'd be more appropriate, and I asked Tom if he wanted to do it, and he said yes, and that's basically it. We got our kit, and we actually released. I didn't have any money for the kit. That was the main problem, too. And me and John put together a map pack of a bunch of levels that people had submitted, and with the money from the sponsorship, we were actually able to put down on a dev kit, and me and Tommy got the dev kit, and that's how it all started.
Yeah, I know. I've been aware of what you've done for a while, at least with I remember Gish. And with Meat Boy, actually, I was in college when it came out last year, and when I actually found out about it from a friend of mine while I was at work in a computer lab, and that basically killed the next like week or two just playing Meat Boy. So thank you. You helped me procrastinate while at work.
I'm happy to help.
But as far as taking Meat Boy and making it super on WiiWare, what exactly did you do to change the game and beef it up, if you will?
I'd say in a lot of ways, Tommy made it super.
That's
Tommy's
sweet.
A super aspect.
That's sweet of you.
So you're just the Meat Boy and he's super?
Yeah, he took it to the super. Yeah.
I super things.
Yeah, you get Tommy involved and things usually get a little more super than they were before.
It's true. It's true.
Yeah.
I make super stuff, basically. Yeah. I guess what makes Super Meat Boy super is it's the same formula as Meat Boy, but it controls a lot better and it looks a lot prettier. And it's got moving saws, I don't know.
when we were talking about what we would name Meat Boy when it was on WiiWare and the idea for Super Meat Boy came out, it just seemed like such a perfect title, and the fact that it abbreviated to SMB was just awesome.
Yeah.
So it's very appropriate. So it had to be called Super Meat Boy. But the thing that makes Super Meat Boy super is that it's far and beyond what the Flash game had to offer tenfold. It's basically a completely remade game. All the faulty aspects of Meat Boy, the Flash game, have been corrected. It controls really, really well. It's really tight. The of course is really good as well. Mm-hmm. And the game is very, very vast compared to in the first chapter, there's a possibility of unlocking and playing over 40 levels, basically. And that's basically how many levels there were in the Flash version. So that's just the first chapter. And there's five chapters and a bunch of extra unlockables, and there's going to be multiplayer and everything else. So in a lot of ways, it's much more super.
Yes.
And many aspects of it that make it so super.
Well, I know one of the really cool things that I've heard about it is how you have all like the guest characters, like Tim from Braid and Commander Video, Alien Hominid. How did that idea of getting those kind of characters into the game come about?
We actually, in the original version of Meat Boy, that was something we wanted to add, like a new element to the platformer genre, where there was like you could cut through the game and you could get to the end, but there was also alternate band-aids that were hidden in levels that if you died with a band-aid, you'd have to start all over. And they're usually placed in places that are kind of expert areas to get to and complete. So we wanted something to kind of unlock when you got those in the original version. And in the first Flash version, I believe we had mostly Newgrounds characters that you unlocked,
mm-hmm.
like Tank Man, and I think there was a Castle Crasher and Gish. And a few others. So that was actually in the original game, and I thought it was cool just to kind of pay homage to Flash games, and that's what I was doing in the Flash version. And with Super Meat Boy, we thought it would be cool to do kind of like a cross-promotion thing. And of course, in a lot of ways, Braid and Alien Hominid help us when we advertise in the game that
mm-hmm.
they're in there. But there's going to be a slew of other more obscure any playable characters that are going to give back to the indie community. And in a lot of ways, Meat Boy is kind of, it's a homage to all video games. It's like everything me and Tommy grew up with and everything we've liked. And indie games, of course, have made a big impact and respect them greatly. And we're friends with everybody, you know, and I thought it'd be a really cool way to, you know, pay homage to what kind of made us and give back to the community and all that good stuff. And
excellent.
I don't foresee an indie Smash Brothers ever happening, so this is going to be the closest most people are going
to
get.
The closest that we'll get to that.
Yeah,
and it's a fun way too to kind of play off some of the characters and you know, it's a whole like pop culture funness.
Yeah.
No. Now, how did the multiplayer come about in Super Meat Boy?
I don't know. Like, we don't actually have, like, official multiplayer, but the other day, Edmund and I were on Skype racing each other to see who could get through the levels first. So, and that was a lot of fun. So we'll probably have something like that. But yeah, it's just, it's like a whole sort of like interaction thing, but like between you and your friends or whatever. Just, yeah, I mean, you know, it just kind of naturally fits with the game's theme overall of like these little quick, fast kind of experiences, and you know, being able to share those with somebody else, and yeah, you know, multiplayer.
it's an easy way to it's kind of funny how working on Meat Boy, the game kind of has a lot of hints of a race game now. Like, there's puzzly aspects, you know, it's every level's super quick and everything else, and there's usually special ways to cut through levels, but like, for us at this point, we've been playing through the first 40 levels for about 3 weeks now, obsessively.
Yeah.
And it's gotten to the point where you play them like racetracks,
mm-hmm.
where it's, you're trying to cut corners, you're trying to shave off a few seconds here in the score and best time. And now that me and Tommy have been competing, which he dominates me every single fucking time.
It's true.
It's still like, I'm still now finding shortcuts through levels to shave off a little bit more time. So it's definitely something that we instantly thought, okay, this is really fun, and we need to do something with this for multiplayer, like basically a race. It's like a set number of levels. Everybody's playing. You can see everybody, basically, and you're running through. So that's something to play around with, too.
Yeah.
But for local multiplayer, we'll probably do a few levels that are very long, and that kind of the person in the lead kind of controls the scroll of the screen. So if the other person falls off, that's basically it. And then we'll probably have a party mode as well, where it's maybe like grab the Band-Aid or something along those lines, where
yeah,
everybody's
like kind of like how the new Super Mario Brothers, I think DS had a multiplayer mode that was,
yeah,
star collecting.
So something similar to that.
Yeah.
Much.
Cool. Now I know with the change from Flash Game to WiiWare, Band-Aid Girl was renamed to Bandage Girl.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And was that just to avoid any complications with the Band-Aid line, or did you actually hear from them?
It was something that Nintendo asked us to be careful about, and unless we had a lawyer that was going to back us up and fight, then we'd be better off changing the name. It's not a huge change,
yeah,
and a lot of people actually refer to her as Bandage Girl. So it's not a huge deal. I think over in the UK they do refer to Band-Aids as bandages. So there's a lot of people that call her Bandage Girl, and you know,
when I first heard the news, I didn't realize there was a change until I was like, oh wait, she was Band-Aid Girl.
Yeah,
no biggie. It's not much of a change.
It's fine. Johnson & Johnson can have their fucking Band-Aids.
Why did you settle on WiiWare as opposed to the other downloadable platforms? Like, well, it is coming to Steam, but on like Xbox Live Arcade or PSN.
Well, right now it's since we were contacted by Nintendo, and they wanted the title, and it, in a lot of ways, Meat Boy is kind of the perfect. I don't know. I mean, how can you pass up Nintendo?
Yeah,
you know,
seriously.
If there's not a more appropriate place for what we're doing and what we have to offer in terms of, like, as a homage to the NES era, I don't know what it is. It just seemed like the perfect fit for it.
Mm.
That and the fact that you turn the Wiimote on its side and you basically got an NES controller, it's like,
yeah,
you can't get any better than that.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like the NES controller kind of thing. It just feels much better than, you know, like keyboard or, you know, Xbox controller or something. It just feels natural. Controls well.
Do you guys have any plans to do any other subsequent WiiWare games together or on any other platforms?
I'm sure we're gonna do a lot of stuff after Meat Boy.
I'm not gonna work with Edmund ever again.
Heard it here first.
It's spiraling out of control for months.
Yeah, I hate it.
It's all over.
I cut myself at night.
Yeah.
It's unrelated.
Never living at my house again.
That's fine.
And then, so Super Meat Boy is set for Q1 2010. Is there any possibility that that date will not be met, or is that pretty much set in stone?
Let's try to make that date.
Yeah, let's, all right. We're going to try to
what
do
you
that.
Say,
I'll try.
I think we're good.
Yeah.
I think we're good on first quarter.
Awesome. I really can't wait. But you had this was just you, Edmund, right, with Time Fuck?
Me and William, another programmer I've been working with, William
oh.
Good.
All right. So how exactly did that come about?
Time Fuck was I wanted to do something for Power of Three, and William had contacted me, and it's funny because he contacted me because I believe, now I could be totally making this up, but who cares? he contacted me a while back. I believe he did a bunch of web programming stuff, and he was making the move to games because he had played Meat Boy and he really liked it, and he wanted to make something tile based like Meat Boy. And he approached me and he's like, "Hey, check out this prototype that I have." And it was really cool. Like, the character was like a bat character, and you could fly around and stuff. But I liked a lot of the mechanics that he was using in it, and I thought it was really cool. And I asked him if he wanted to make a game with me, and maybe we could do it for Power 3, which was a Newgrounds test type, I don't know what you want to call it, get-together thing.
Yeah.
And where you get, like, a musician, an artist, and a programmer together and make a game. And Power of Three. So me and William started working on it, and it just kind of turned into this insane game. But it was basically around the time where I had I just had my 10-year high school reunion, and it was really depressing. It was just kind of like a bunch of people that were not happy with where they were, and there was a lot of drinking, and a lot of people were crying, and it was just kind of an embarrassing, disturbing situation of just watching, seeing all these people that have, basically, I felt like time had been frozen, and 10 years later, all these people are the same people that they were in high school, but they're miserable, and it just kind of got me thinking of the whole idea of, like, changing your perspective, and I know a lot of games now, and changing perspective, but they never really talk much about what it means, you know, what perspective means, and the importance of having experiences in life and being able to see things from another perspective. And that's kind of where the basis came in. I wanted to make a game about a guy who was stuck in a box, but through experience and changing his perspective on life, he was able to see other options. And that's kind of the basis of the game. And that's where the basic idea came from. But I worked on it pretty casually, though. I only worked on it a few hours on the weekends because me and Tommy were still working on Meat Boy. And I worked on it on the weekends for a few months. But as you can see, I mean, the art was minimal because I couldn't work much on it. and I think I got away with it, though. It was pretty cool to be able to play with something so minimal but yet so expressive, I guess. I feel like a lot of the I got to put on ideas and gameplay and theme, and I think it held up.
But now, what was the reasoning behind the name, besides, like, I guess to as far as having it misspelled and having it misspelled? What was the like the reasoning behind that?
The original reasoning was to play off the idea of seeing something for what it's not. Like, really, the name's not Time Fuck. It's nothing. Like, but your brain sees fuck because those are the letters there, even though realistically it's not at all the word anymore. Once you switch something around, it no longer has the meaning that it did. And it kind of is just a play on how retarded the idea of a curse word is. How ridiculous it is. It was just a fun thing. I wanted to be able to see if someone would have a problem with it, because realistically, because it's not the word at all. And it just blows my mind that, like, I can misspell the word fuck, right? I can spell it, you know, KUFC, and it can go up on a website, and someone will complain that it's hey, when you rearrange the letters, that spells a bad word.
My yet, kids go to this site.
They would be okay with me putting asterisks. It just doesn't make any sense. And the whole idea is society tells you something, and you believe it. And you believe it's bad without questioning it. And that's what the whole game's about. It's like, do you want to be put in this box and somehow think that a word is going to hurt you? It doesn't make any sense. It has no relevance. It's completely retarded, and it's something society puts out and says, hey, this could be the word fuck, and that word means having sex. Now, if you say time sex, that's okay. What? This doesn't make any sense. It means the same thing. This is not logical in the slightest. Society says that there are words that are bad that we can't say, then people want to censor those words and yada, yada, yada. But it just it went with the theme of the game, and I thought it was fun, so I rearranged the letters, and the fun ensued.
Yeah, I definitely like the description where you keep on changing up the arrangement of the letters.
It's always funny when I get emails or comments saying that I misspelled.
Yeah, but I guess to wrap this up, I guess kind of in the same vein as Time Fox name. I didn't realize that you made a game called Cunt, in which you play a penis and you're shooting a vagina.
I did make a game called Cunt where you're a penis and vagina. Yeah.
How exactly did that idea come about?
Well, I believe I had just finished Ether, and I thought, hey, I want to do something reminiscent of the stuff that I did when I was younger, and I wanted to kind of prove my independence. I want to commit... what's the word? I wanted to destroy my future. I wanted to do something that proved that I was completely independent and I didn't have to answer to anybody. And that was basically it. And it was just, I wanted to do something. I mean, realistically, that game's very pretty. It has some of my best illustrations that I've done in years. Of course, it's genitals or whatever, but I mean, that didn't matter much to me. I made it in 9 days with Florian Himsel. He was the guy that I did Coil with and Triacnid. And it was just a fun little lewd joke. That's all it was. And it was just to show, the amount of freedom that you have when you're independent, not having to answer to anybody. It's just something that I could never have done on anything. It was originally something I thought I could never make money off of, and I wanted to just do it because, and that's exactly what I did, and that's all it means.
Yeah, I definitely found it interesting when I did stumble upon it, and I saw all the negative reactions from different feminist blogs and stuff like that.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah.
You can't win an argument with a feminist after you make a game called Cunt.
You're
kind of fucked after that.
You should just steer clear of feminists in general. They'll be like, Edmund McMillen, that name's familiar. Oh, you're that guy who made that game Cunt.
Yeah, that's
it's
fine,
like,
whatever.
But see, that's the thing. Did you make Cunt to piss off feminists? No. They got pissed off at it on their own... At their own pace, their own accord. So it's kind of their fault that they're offended by it. Because that wasn't the purpose.
Yeah, it's not like you set out to offend people and people got offended.
Well, that's if it gives them something to do and write about, then great, super.
Yeah, whatever.
I mean, it gave. if it inspired creative writing, that's awesome. And that gives them something to vent about. That's cool. That's fine.
Well, thank you very much for coming on and talking to us about the different games that you guys make.
We could talk more about Meat Boy if you have questions about it, though. I feel like we didn't talk much about Meat Boy.
I think you've answered most of what I had to say, or most of the questions that I had. If you have anything else that you want to say about it, by all means, go for it.
Tommy, what should we say about Meat Boy?
It's a pretty good game.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
It's
pretty good game.
Yeah, it's a Citizen Kane of games.
I thought that was Metroid Prime.
No, it's Sophie. I'm sorry, it's the Sophie's Choice of video games. I don't know what the choice is, but it definitely is, and I should be quoted on that.
Probably will now.
Awesome.
It'll be big news. Maybe it'll get to CBS or CNN or whatever.
Good. Good.
I'll try to pimp it in that direction. Hey, this guy said Super Meat Boy is going to be the Sophie's Choice of video games.
That seems logical to me.
Yeah.
I've never seen Sophie's Choice, so I. What's Sophie's Choice about? Isn't it about somebody has to pick which one of their kids goes to the Nazis? Isn't that it?
I don't even know.
I think it is.
It probably is. That makes sense.
I think because Sophie has to choose which one of her kids die. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. So, yes, Meat Boy is the Sophie's Choice of the
game. You'll find out why at the end of the game when you buy it.
Yeah, when at the end of the game. You know, whatever.
Don't give it away. We've alluded to the ending.
I know. We've given away too much. No one's going to buy the game now. Because they know what happens at the end. You travel back in time to Sophie and you make the choice for her.
Dude!
Sophie's trying to figure out, and then a little meat boy appears on her shoulder. Or a giant meat boy, maybe.
Yeah, and then he just throws a saw at both the kids.
Makes the choice for her. Choice answered.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty bad.
But, you know, yeah, Meat Boy's awesome. Meat Boy's rad. We just, Tommy just demoed it at TIG Jam.
Yeah.
And,
oh, yeah.
They broke the D-pad.
Yeah, I bought one of those Mad Catz, like $50 fight pads for Street Fighter 4. And at the end of TIG Jam, my left button doesn't work anymore.
Oh.
Yeah. Sucks.
Are you excited for Super Street Fighter 4?
Very much so.
Yeah, it was actually demoed because I'm around New Jersey. It's being shown off in New York City, but I regrettably cannot go.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, along with Tatsunoko versus Capcom and the new crazy characters in that.
Yeah, yeah. I'm people bitch about Super Street Fighter being like $40 or whatever and not being all download, but like that's Street Fighter 4 was the last game I bought, like last $50 or $60 game I bought, and it's provided me with more entertainment than any movie I've been to, anything like that. So yeah, I'll gladly pay another $40 in another year. I mean, it's not coming out for another year, so
yeah, it's not coming out until spring. I think March is the estimated date.
Yeah,
Street Fighter is the last game that I bought as well.
Yeah, I seriously haven't bought anything else. I might buy that Metroid trilogy. But I mean,
you keep talking about that. When are you going to fucking buy it?
Hey.
It's been out for like 2 months at this point.
It's like 3 months.
I know. Well, see, now I'm faced with the dilemma, because when I was at Kyle's house for TIG Jam, I played almost all the way through Metroid Prime. And I don't want to have to do that again.
Did you see the similarities of Citizen Kane and Metroid Prime?
I didn't, because I've never seen Citizen Kane.
I've seen Citizen Kane. What are the similarities? I thought it would be more similar to the... the second one, right?
I don't even know what the similarities are supposed to be. It's just that, I mean, as you both know, there was the report with, I think, someone from IGN on, like, CNN or something that said it was the Citizen's Kane of video games.
They're just saying it's good.
Yeah, I think that's about it.
Yeah. That's all there.
I missed the scene where...
similarities are closer to the second one, where there's a bad Metroid.
Yeah.
A bad Samus.
Could Kane morph into a morph ball?
I think
he can. On the cover of the movie, I think he's about to morph into the morph.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I missed the part in the beginning of the first Metroid Prime where the Chozo dropped the snow globe and said Rosebud.
At the end.
That's yeah. Oh, yeah, I want to say one more thing. iPhone is dumb. And the next person that asks if Meat Boy's coming to the iPhone, I'm going to go to their house and I'm going to kick them.
Well, how would you control the game?
Exact. Thank you.
The touchpad?
Thank you.
You throw it.
Yeah.
You throw it.
Oh, you just wiggle it.
Shake it up and down and Meat Boy jumps around.
Use the accelerometer. It's like an etch-and-sketch. And you just shake him and he goes over the saw. It's stupid. People ask this stuff all the time, and they're like, "Oh, you make a lot of money on iPhone." I'm like, "Well, yeah, I can make a lot of money, you know, if I won the lottery too." Yeah, so
I can become a man whore.
I can make a lot of money if I went out on the street.
You make an iPhone game and I'll suck dicks.
We'll come back at the end of the month and see who has more money, and I guarantee you'll have more money than I will.
And I'll have AIDS.
And I just won't have a soul.
Yeah. But at least you have the experience.
Yeah.
You've gained perspective.
I know perspective.
Full circle with this. I'm going full circle. I'm going back to time fuck here. After all the dick sucking, you gain perspective, right?
Yeah.
And now you see things as like, oh, well, you know, I have options. I don't have to make an iPhone game. I can make a few bucks sucking dick on the street.
I can charge $8 for a hand job, and I can charge $12 for a blow job. And, you know, that's a lot more than a 99-cent app. So every time I suck some guy off, it's like I sold 12 games. This isn't going in the podcast, is it?
That guy's getting way more entertainment.
It's fun for both of the people.
Yep. I'm like, I'd hate to tell Adam this, but blowjob versus cannibal.
I'd much rather pay $3 for a blowjob.
Whatever.
You know, it's fine.
They need a blowjob port on the iPhone.
Yeah, if they did that.
They probably do.
Where's that peripheral?
Yeah. I'm going to make that.
Don't put this in the podcast. We make that peripheral.
Yeah. We'll cut you in. We'll cut you in for your silence.
Super Meat Boy is rated T for teen.
Because in America, you can show blood and things getting tore up by saws and dying, but don't you dare show a nipple. If you show a nipple, it's over.
Or don't make a reference to blowjobs.
Yeah, and you can't say fuck, because if you say fuck, that's wrong.
Yep, but you can have a little meat boy mutilated by saws, and that's fine.
Oh, that's adorable when he gets mutilated by the saws, so I guess that's it.
Ooh. We will make a game. Me and Tommy will make a game that involves blowjobs.
Yes.
One of these days.
I will definitely play that game.
It'll be
after this.
Everyone will play it because it'll be the Green Mile. The Green Mile of video games.
This is some what else? The fucking Paranormal Activity of video games. Horrible.
What was that one? Was it Four Rooms? Or was that the one Tarantino did?
That's the one with Madonna. Four Rooms had Madonna in it.
What was the one?
Was that the Guy Ritchie movie with Madonna? Or
it was old.
Yeah, I doubt it was.
Could have been, huh?
Well, it was... Ah, shit. It's this really horrible movie.
I've heard of it. I've never seen
it. It's called Rooms something. I gotta find it.
Room something.
You told me to download it.
What are you talking about?
It had the really stupid, cheesy sex scenes in it, and the acting was really, really bad.
Rooms? I told you to download this?
It was... Fuck, what was it called?
And I was like, hey, Tommy, you need to download this because it's awesome or because it's horrible?
Because it's horrible. And really? I did, and I watched it, and it's...
Oh, wait, the Room?
The Room, yeah!
Yes.
Is that
yes.
it?
That is a terrible movie. It's very funny, but it's a terrible movie.
Wait, I don't know what you guys are fucking talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, that's the one!
With Tommy Wiseau.
Yeah, it's so bad.
What is it?
You gotta look it up on YouTube. I thought you told
me
this.
I don't know what you're fucking talking about, The Room.
Somebody told me to download this, and I did.
It wasn't me.
I downloaded it.
Whatever.
Yeah, it's a horrendously terrible movie that they have screenings of it monthly in like New York and Los Angeles.
It's so good.
It's good in the fact that it's one of the worst movies ever made.
Yeah.
Hey, Neil, did you see Paranormal Activity?
No, I have not.
Don't. Don't see that movie.
Is it really that bad?
Horrible, horrible. There's a reason why you can't find a torrent of that fucking movie out there. The moment that thing gets leaked, no one's going to go see it because it's awful.
All I hear is how scary it is.
It's not scary! If you fucking believe that that movie is real, maybe it's scary, but if you do, you're a fucking fool.
Well, I never even heard of this movie until you told me that it was shitty.
Yeah, well, I was so duped into it. It's like...
Who's
like
in
the
it?
Blair Witch Project seems like... The Blair Witch Project seems like Citizen Kane. That
movie. This is the Citizen Kane of podcasts at this point.
I think it is, actually. This is...
Yeah, no, I've heard a lot about Paranormal Activities, but can't say I have much interest in seeing it because I've heard a lot of dissenting opinions.
Was it, like re-released or something?
It originally came out, I think, like 2 years ago, and it just never was released.
I don't know any of these people in this.
It was, I think it was very low budget. I think Steven Spielberg supposedly, he turned off the movie halfway through it because he was so scared. And then I think DreamWorks put it on theaters. Paranormal Activities.
Okay, I thought you were talking about the other movie, The Room.
Oh no!
Oh, I was so scared.
That's a frightening movie when they have.
No, it's fucking horrible. It's don't anybody who listens to this, if this is going to end up in the podcast, never see that movie. Don't give them money. They made like $30 million or something.
They made $30 million.
And they spent 11 to make it. It is horrible. And I got a news flash is what they could call it, I believe. A news flash for everybody who's listening to this, who sees that movie, who believes that it's somehow real. Your face doesn't morph all CG crazy. That's not real life. You know, when you do like crazy motion blurring and your face morphs. No, that's not real. That's movies.
What? What do you mean?
Yeah. It's not real.
That's
it's not real, therefore it's not scary. And that's that.
So video games.
Meat Boy.
Yeah, Super Meat Boy coming out Q1 2010.
That's right.
Greatest game ever.
Everybody that went and saw Paranormal Activity needs to buy Meat Boy. It's like
seriously.
That'll make up for the fact
scary,
that that movie made money.
If you think Paranormal Activity is scary, then you should buy two or three copies of this.
Yeah, because you'll turn them off halfway through. I'm gonna send
scary.
A copy to Steven Spielberg, and then somehow he can douche it up or something. I don't know.
He'll just make it into boom blocks.
Yeah, that's what he wants to do.
That game was actually pretty fun.
Was it?
Boom blocks is really fun.
I never played it.
Paranormal Activities, I guess.
My niece did play Super Meat Boy. I have video footage of it.
I saw that.
She did say it was scary. She was scared.
She was scared by the spikes.
If you're three, then Meat Boy is scarier than Paranormal.
So I will avoid showing this to my niece.
Don't.
Scary.
It's too scary for a niece.
Alright. Well, it's rated T for teen, right?
It's, yeah.
Yeah.
So that would explain it. It's too
I'm
scary.
Going to jail for letting her play it.
Jack Thompson will hunt you down.
I hope he does.
Yeah, that'd be too awesome.
That would be great press right there, to have Jack Thompson
sue us.
That's
when we know we've made it.
Yeah.
When Jack Thompson says, hey, I'm mad about something.
I can't practice law anymore, but I'm going to sue you anyway.
Why did my wife leave me?
You know what we should do? We should just make up shit about Jack Thompson and try to get him to sue us.
Yeah, I heard Jack Thompson can't get it up unless he plays Grand Theft Auto.
I heard that the only way he can get it up is by killing hookers in Grand Theft Auto and then door-checking people.
I heard that, too. I read that on his blog.
I also heard that he inserts his pinky into the hole of his penis, and that's the only way that he can litigate in the courtroom.
Yeah,
it's disgusting. I
heard that too.
It's disgusting. I don't even want to talk about it, but it's true. It's a fact.
I've seen him do it.
Yeah, I have a YouTube video of it.
he made me watch it.
It's disgusting.
Super Meat Boy.
And I think
I'm the WiiWare.
That's as good a time as any to close this off. Thank you very much for coming on. And well, I mean, we didn't talk about video games much for the past 10 minutes, but it was fun. So that's all that matters.
True.
Yeah, you play the game when it comes out. It's really fucking fun. That's all you need to know.
Yeah, from the moment I heard it get announced on WiiWare, I've been excited.
If you like video games and you like fun things, it's honestly like Mario for kids or people with ADD. That is the perfect tagline for it, because it's like beating a full chapter of Mario within like 10 seconds every time, and you're playing it over and over and over and over again.
Yeah.
All these new levels constantly. It's like 10,000 Marios wrapped into one.
Yes, exactly.
Not WiiWare! First quarter, 2010. Be there.
Be there. Or stay at home and buy it.
Yeah, you can stay at home. You don't have to be there.
You don't have to leave your house, nerd.
Yeah, you just need an internet connection and a Wii.
Hey, nerd. Nerd, do you want a new experience and you don't want to leave the house? Well, good. We're here for you.
All right, there you go.
All right.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.